promise that he brings, there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. Hello, and thank you for joining us. Whenever you're watching this, we're glad that you, and we're trusting that many will end up seeing these programs, but we've been developing the idea of Revelation, the book of Revelation in the Bible, the last book of the Bible, the summary statement till it's all over. And so we are looking forward to sharing each of these weeks. We took chapter 1, and then last time we took chapter 2 and 3, the seven churches in Asia Minor, and trust that that was helpful to you. Now we're going to move to chapter 4 and chapter 5, and I just want to explain very simply that there's not much to say about this except, and I'm going to actually read, as far as I know, I'll read it all for you, but I want you to listen as I read, and then we'll stop at various points to make an explanation. So, but again, thank you. We're excited about this project and believe it can bless many, working on the principle that Revelation is not a hard book to understand, but we're talking about a simplified approach to the book of Revelation. Thank you again. All right, it's chapter 4, verse 1 that I'm starting at. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was, as it were, a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. There was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their head crowns of gold. So I'll stop there a moment. The reason that there's not much to say here is that none of us, very few, have been to heaven. Now, we do have people that have gone, and they've been given certain visiting rights to Canada, and while they were out of their body, and then they've come back to the real world, and movies have been made and other things, but it's very vague. Even the movies have to project sort of a sensitivity or just a vision, but they can't really say what it's like. But here I want us to just simply know that we don't have to know this. All we have to know is exactly what he said. He was called to come up and to look around in heaven. And that's the story here. In these both chapters deal specifically with this arrangement. And so this is... Now, when we get down to verse 4, I read for you about the 24 elders. And pictures is understood by most scholars, those 24 elders. Now, remember, we're taking the Bible from the beginning and from creation to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's 4,000-year period approximately, and then the next period from Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection till we come to the end, or what Revelation is going to talk about it from 6 to 22. So that's the scenario. And these 24 elders are sitting here, and they're beautifully robed, etc. But the point is, it's understood that the 12 of those 24 represent the Old Testament patriarchs, the sons of Jacob. And the other 12 represented by the 12 apostles as Jesus called to serve him and to work with him. And so those two are representing like the 4,000 years and then now the 2,000-year period. And so it's just a representation, but we'll see them in action in a little bit. Okay, in verse 5 it says, "And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. In the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind." Let me just go back to the fifth verse, which says about the seven lamps. And so we understand that John had seen on earth the seven candlesticks, and Jesus said he was walking in the midst of those. Now, this is a picture of that same sense in heaven, the seven lamps, the lights of the church, but also then it says that these are the seven spirits of God. And I just want to say this, there's not much that we know about that except that seven is God's perfect number. God has used it several times as a specific purpose, and even when he created the world, he created it day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, and then on the seventh day, he rested and said, "It's over, it's finished." And so that gives the picture or the concept then that seven is the day of completion or perfection. And so that is here, and that's the only representation that I would understand he's talking about in these verses. But let us read on then in verse 7. "And the first beast was like a lion, the second beast like a calf, and the third beast like the face, or had the face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle." And let me just stop there. I mean, it's an interesting picture. We have these beasts. One is like a lion, one is like a calf, one is like a beast, which has a face as a man, and the fourth beast was a flying eagle. Now, I would be deceiving you if I knew all that that's about. But I do know that typically in the study of the four Gospels, that these same images are used to identify the focus and the purpose of each of the four Gospels, so that then Matthew becomes representing as Jesus as a lion. In the second book, Mark, as a beast, a calf, and that was in those days the working element, the power sources for the farms, and et cetera, and travel, anything was done by beasts. Then next one is the third beast had a face as a man. Now, Luke's gospel he calls himself the Son of Man, or Jesus calls himself the Son of Man in that gospel. And so then there it's represented then Jesus is lion, Jesus is the working source or the strength, the source of strength and work. Then here he is the Son of Man, technically the representative of man. But the last one says the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And this, the soaring eagle, now is the representation of that which is above the earth. And this is where Jesus comes in here as he is king, or he is the Lord. He is above. And so the flying eagle soars over and is above all. So John, in his gospel, he represents that fullness of Jesus. And that's where we get verses like, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Or other places where he says, I am the truth, the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. So there's an analogy of those four beasts. Now, I know that we wouldn't understand that, but in heaven it will make sense. All right, then in verse 8, and the four beasts had each of them six wings about them, and they were full of eyes, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And so there again, we get that which was and is to come, speaking of Jesus. Holy, 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 a triune representation of the holiness of the Lord. And so it says these are their creatures, these beasts, these creatures are simply there to give glory to God. And when these beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever. And when they did that, the 10th verse tells us the 24 elders fell down before him, before Jesus, and before him that sat on the throne, which is Jesus, and worship him that lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things. For thy pleasure they are created. Now, are and were created. So this is the reality here. This is a picture in heaven. This is what these people represent, or these visions, the 24 elders, the four beasts, and then this is what they do. And they cry, Holy, holy, holy. But this is, so that's chapter 4, very simplistic. You can just read it. You can understand the words, and you can know. Now, I understand I'm saying some stuff that you might want to look into, but that's what the typical understanding is. So let's go quickly to chapter 5. And this, we'll see more of this same unfolding. We'll see things that we can't explain, but we'll see what we and hear what we can explain. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with the seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much. Now, this is John. This is now our John the writer, and he's been taken up into heaven. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And of course, we all, I believe most of us have probably heard the idea that, and we even use it casually perhaps, and say, well, in God's book, or and then Jesus make, or the Bible makes reference to our names being written. in the Lamb's Book of Life. And another place, it tells us of those who are not going to be in heaven, it says, whose names are not written in that book. So that's the sense of it. This is the history, this is the future of every living human being. And here is what this chapter deals with some. But so that's the picture there. But then no one was worthy. But now in verse 5, one of the elders, that's one of those 24 and 20 elders, one of the elders said unto me, "Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah." There's your lion from the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. Now, simply then, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the 12 patriarchs, Judah was the fourth son born, and for God's supreme purpose, he chose that Judah would have a son would have a man or a king named David that would be in his lineage, and then David, who became very, very famous as a king in the Old Testament and was sort of the market and mark of what was great in Israel for years. And so then this is where he is brought out. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. So Jesus comes from the tribe of Judah. He also comes from the root of David. And he, Jesus, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. So now there's a whole lot of things that we see here, but it's the fact that Jesus is the only one. You can only come to the Lord, to God, through the Lord Jesus Christ. You can only have salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can only receive the Holy Spirit because Jesus has sent the Holy Spirit into the world. And so every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father above. And Jesus has brought that down to earth. So simply, what a picture, what a picture. And I beheld, verse 6, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And again, the event that brought Jesus to the earth and that ended his earthly life here, and he shed his blood so that when he was raised from the dead, that we could believe in him, any human, anywhere, any time. And the Old Testament saints, they had practiced sacrifices that looked forward to the blood of Jesus coming. But we look back and say, thank you, Jesus. I believe that you died for me and rose again, and I invite you into my life. So that's the picture here of salvation, complete and final. And now it uses that number 7 again, and again it's, I can only understand it, that is representing the completeness of God's salvation provided in the Old Testament, but also the completeness of salvation provided in the New Testament. Let's read on. And this, the Lamb or Jesus, he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of saints. And here's a verse that if you read that, you don't have to understand again all of it, but simply that this is a representation of our salvation, of our hope in Jesus Christ, and it says that these come about because of what Jesus has done, and then it says, and also the prayers of the saints. So you can pray for whoever you will, and that will have an effect on whether they come to know the Lord or not as their personal Savior. Okay, verse 9, and they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and that thou hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Now, Revelation is going to talk more about that and when it takes place and how it functions, etc. But right now, we find at the end of the book that it's another 1,000-year period in which we learn so much from God and how to life is to be run. But anyway, don't let me leave you there. But we shall reign on the earth with him. And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts, and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000s, times 10,000s, and thousands and thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. In other words, just so much greatness you can't get it all said. And every creature which is in heaven and on earth, under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them are, I heard saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb forever. And the four beasts said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever. And so, ultimately, the picture of eternity, and see, this picture is after the rapture. The rapture takes place, and the Christians are taken out of the world. They are in heaven, and this is what they're singing and they're saying, and they give that undefinable number because there's going to be an undefinable number in terms of human logic or time to count, but that it's okay. We can all be there as we invite the Lord to change our lives, to save us, to forgive us our sins, and just live for him, because the time is short, the days are short, and we know that Jesus has perfected the work. And we've just, chapter 4, chapter 5 gives us that little picture in heaven. It's going to be so fantastic that we have to live forever so we can figure it all out, so we can see it all, and so we can even be part of creating whatever else God has in store in heaven and on earth for us. God bless you. Thank you for listening.
Rest with wonders anew, but I hold on to this hope in the promise that he brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will face to face.